Our scripture this morning, our first scripture, comes from Exodus 16, 1 through 4. The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the Sin Desert, which is located between Elim and Sinai. They set out on the 15th day of the second month after they had left the land of Egypt. The whole Israelite community complained against Moses and Aaron in the desert. The Israelites said to them, "Oh, how we wish that the Lord had just put us to death while we were still in the land of Egypt. There we could sit by the pots cooking meat and eat our fill of bread. Instead, you've brought us out into the desert to starve this whole assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to make bread rain down from the sky for you. The people will go out each day and gather just enough for that day. In this way, I'll test them to see whether or not they follow my instructions." And our second scripture, a little bit later in the same story, from Numbers 11, 4 through 6. The riffraff among them had a strong craving. Even the Israelites cried again and said, "Who will give us meat to eat? We remember the fish we ate in Egypt for free, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. Now our lives are wasting away. There is nothing but manna in front of us." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, we say, thanks be to God. Here at our party last night?
No.
Some of you were.
Yeah.
I saw some of you. that's a holiday, but we're not celebrating. Well, we can say. So what holiday comes next?
Thanksgiving.
Oh, Thanksgiving. Well, you're right, that's coming up.
Christmas.
So, yeah, there's a few other holidays. We're going to talk about some other holidays that actually come before Thanksgiving. But leading up to Thanksgiving, everybody got one of these in their bulletins, and there's more on the table as you go to the community room. This is a gratitude calendar. So every day of November, starting Wednesday, it asks you something you're thankful for. So a moment you're thankful for, a memory, a color, a song. There's all kinds of things that they ask for you to write down. So this is for you to take home with your families and do this together every day to remember all the stuff you are thankful for, because that's what we're talking about for this whole month of November. But there's a few other holidays before Thanksgiving, but there's one that we're celebrating today. Do you know what it is? I have a video. You ready to watch it? We'll find out what this holiday is.
Halloween is fun, for it's candy you seek. But did you know it's not the only holiday this week? All Saints' Day falls on the 1st of November, and we celebrate it together as a way to remember the saints of the church, both famous and not, for their example of faith and for loving a lot. What is a saint, you might ask your pastor? But I'll answer that question. It's probably faster. Saints are people who love God and others. They see everyone on earth as their sisters and brothers. We give thanks for those who have died this last year. We say their names. We smile. We might shed a tear. And as they sing God's praises, we can join in the chorus by doing for others what the saints have done for us. Be kind. Forgive. Tell other people about the love of God that makes you want to shout, God is great. God is good. God always comes through, just like the Bible said God would. So enjoy your candy, but don't forget to say, along with trick or treat, Happy All Saints Day.
So today we celebrate All Saints Day. Do you know anybody who, according to this description, we would call a saint? Do you know anyone we're celebrating today?
No.
Yeah, somebody who's passed away. Do you know anybody who's passed away?
No.
Oh, I
know
my dad.
Yeah, we all know. You probably all know some people who have passed away. And there's a few people, six actually, who passed away that were members of our church this year. So I need a volunteer to light their candles for them. Come on forward. We have six candles over here. And come here. And you're going to light each one. Lois Coles. Mary Margaret Deo. Margaret Easton. Joyce Jones. Ken Jones. And Ben Painter.
It's on fire.
Thank you.
Good job.
Those little candles are hard to light. So we remember these six people that were members of our church, and they probably knew you, if you don't remember them. But we remember them today and everybody who has helped us grow as people, especially in our faith, who have taught us something about God. So So later on, the grown-ups are going to be writing those names down of people that have helped them, and you guys are welcome to come back in after Sunday school to add those names to the rocks as well. So let's pray, and we pray with thanksgiving for these people. We give thanks for all they have taught us, and that they will help, their love will help us continue to grow, because we know even though they're not here, their love is still with us. Their love never stops. So let's pray. God, we thank you for all the people who have helped us grow. And we thank you for their love that continues to love us and guide us. That it would help us keep going and keep seeing the blessings that you bring us. Help us know that they are cheering us on as we grow in our faith. And so each day we pray that you help us find something to be thankful for in the month ahead. We ask your blessing on these children, that you would keep them safe and bring them back next week to keep learning more about you. And all of God's children said, Amen. Most holy, gracious God, make your truth known to us today and forever. O God, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today we officially are beginning this intentional season of thankfulness. You know, Christmas can kind of take over almost the whole fall, but we want to use this month leading up to Thanksgiving to focus through a sermon series on gratitude, and specifically the things that keep us from living all the time as just grateful fountains of thanksgiving. Because that's what we could be if we really stopped and thought about in every moment all the blessings that surround us, right? If we were really focused and tuned in to what God is doing in our lives and in the world, and if we were totally centered on Christ, we would just be saying thank you with every breath, wouldn't we? Well, it's interesting because modern psychology actually says it's the other way around. That when we practice gratitude, especially when maybe we're having a hard time and it's hard to see the things to be thankful for, when we practice gratitude, we end up becoming happier in all the aspects of our lives. Studies suggest that being grateful can improve our well-being, not just our mental health, but our physical health. Can strengthen our relationships and produce positive emotional states. And it helps us cope with stress as we go through difficult times. Psychologists are saying that gratitude is more than just a social nicety, you know, saying thanks, is really a way of helping the other party know that what they've done is really appreciated. It reassures them and encourages further similar behavior. It brings out more goodness when we show our thanks. So the number one suggestion given to people all the time who are looking to improve their lives is to keep a thankfulness journal. Commit to writing down your thanksgivings, your gratitudes each day. So I'm excited for that calendar that you all received. And of course, our thankfulness guru, Miss Oprah Winfrey, instructs us to be thankful for what we have because we'll end up having more. If we concentrate on what we don't have, we'll never have enough. She says, I'm a big believer in the power and benefits of being grateful. I think it's a cornerstone in building your best life. Appreciating what shows up in your life changes your personal vibration. Gratitude elevates your life to a higher frequency. You will radiate goodness when you bring your attention to what you have, giving thanks for it, and stop focusing on what you don't. Because what you focus on is what expands. I couldn't have said it better, Oprah. I absolutely believe this to be true. We've seen it. Gratitude does elevate our lives to a higher frequency. You know the people that walk around who are thankful? You want to be around them. You will radiate and generate more goodness when you practice thankfulness. Because each time we give thanks to God, that's the key for me, is that we're not just saying thanks, we're giving thanks to God. Even for the little mundane things of our lives, each time we do that, we are reminded of the great love of our Creator. Every time we say, thank you, God, we are reminded that God would do anything for us. Now, if that's not a way to live your best life, I don't know what is. There are literally no negatives to practicing gratitude. But for some reason, I don't think I'm alone here, we need reminders. Thankfulness is unfortunately not the default attitude of our culture. Even though we are among some of the most privileged in the world, we lose sight of that. So that's why we're going to take this season, this month, leading up to Thanksgiving, to address the things in our lives that keep us from being grateful at all times. And the first enemy of gratitude that we're going to look at today is nostalgia. Now, as you heard me talk about with the kids, we're also celebrating All Saints Sunday. So, we're remembering the members and the loved ones who have left this world and gone on to the next. And you perhaps are thinking, Pastor, you're telling us nostalgia is an enemy of gratitude, and yet you're asking us to think back and remember our loved ones who have gone on. Those don't really seem to go together. But they do. And I hope you'll see why by the end of my sermon. First of all, nostalgia isn't all bad. It's defined as a sentiment longing for wistful affection of the past, typically a period or place with happy personal associations. That's great stuff, and it has its time and place in our lives. It can be hopeful and healing to sit around and reminisce with friends and family. It's wonderful to think back and remember the good old days when things may have seemed simpler. However, nostalgia is not necessarily a healthy place to live your whole life. Reverend Brian Erickson of Birmingham says, "Nostalgia never leads you forward, because nostalgia casts an impossible standard, a candy-coated, much-improved rendering of what once was. The present can never match an idealized past, leaving us stuck in the quicksand of our edited memories, perpetually ungrateful for the place we now find ourselves. Nostalgia quietly steals our joy and makes us indifferent to the blessings God is providing here in this time and place. We see it time and again. And the two passages of scripture that I read earlier are the perfect example. Those are just two snippets of the much larger story of the Israelites' 40-year journey through the desert to the Promised Land. And so, for a refresher, story goes, Egypt had taken the Israelites as slaves. Though they were God's chosen people, they were enslaved by this larger nation. And then Moses was called to lead the whole country of slaves out of Egypt to freedom. And through a series of miracles and thousands of Israelites escaped, and the Red Sea parted, and they were able to get to freedom. But they found themselves now in the desert. And God told Moses that they would be led to a land flowing of milk and honey, a fertile, peaceful place for the Israelites to finally call their own, to call home, where they could live out their mission. What they were supposed to be doing was showing the rest of the world how to live in harmony with our Creator. But they find themselves in the desert, and very quickly they get hangry, right? They start complaining. They'd be better off dead back in Egypt. They're going to starve to death out here. So God tells Moses, I will provide manna, this mysterious food substance. Every morning there will be just enough for you. Amazing. Incredible. But after a while, they get sick of the manna. They start complaining again. This time, they say they miss Egypt, where they could eat whatever they wanted to eat for free. Anybody catch that?
Yeah.
They were slaves. They weren't eating anything for free. They gave their freedom, and they got some food so that they could build the pyramids for the Egyptians. I could just imagine Moses about lost his mind when they started wishing to go back to slavery. They had so quickly idealized this past where they had fish and cucumbers that they forgot they were slaves. This kind of stuff can make leaders go a little bit crazy. We get caught up in nostalgia. It's not just the older folks. These were Israelites of every age, right? I found myself doing it as well. We all like to sit back with people our age and think, well, back in my day, things were different. I've even heard our high school youth talk about kids these days just don't know what's good anymore. I am not lying. I've heard 16-year-olds say that. So it's not something that any of us are exempt from. We all love to look back at this time when we were children, when we didn't have responsibilities, which is why life probably seemed perfect and magical. It seems natural to look back fondly on the past, but we see in this example of the Israelites how dangerous it can be if we're not taking the whole picture into account. If we're missing the miracles that are happening right here and now. God provided food for them out of the air, but they would rather go back to slavery. You know, when we talk about the good old days, sometimes I have to think, well, do we mean back during segregation? Those good old days? Do we mean back when it was okay for a husband to harm his wife? Do we mean when people who felt different thought they had to hide who they were? Or when we stripped the earth of all its resources without concern for the environment? Are those the good old days? For us, maybe they were. But we have to remember they weren't perfect for everyone. Things are better now for a bigger part of the population. Now, that isn't to say we need to be jaded about the past. We certainly can fondly reminisce about our childhood. But when we start comparing the past to the present, let's make sure we have the whole picture about both. Let's make sure we don't miss the incredible things that are still happening. And maybe that's the best thing we can do with our nostalgia, is to allow it to remind us to give thanks for all the wonderful things God is still doing today. So today we remember and we celebrate the saints, the people of faith, our loved ones who have gone before us and helped us get where we are today. We do this each year as a church, and I know throughout the years we individually do it. Not as a way to fall into a rut of nostalgia, but we celebrate and remember because we're told those who move on to the next life, that they join a faithful cloud of witnesses, a group that surrounds us still, that cheers us on as we continue on the path of faith that they started us on. We know, or I hope we know, that the faithful people we celebrate today don't want us getting stuck, sitting around wishing for a time when they were here with us physically. They want us to know that their love still surrounds us and that they left us with some work to continue. They want us to know that they're cheering us on to move forward. I heard of a tradition a little while ago where some churches will put rocks in their baptismal font to symbolize the living water that we use in baptism. And so we've collected 6 rocks, one for each of those members in our church who have gone on to the next life this year. We know they have joined the cloud of faithful witnesses. We know they're cheering us on right now. We know that their lives laid a foundation for our faith. And so we're going to use these rocks to symbolize that foundation. They will be placed in the baptismal font as a representation of God's living water that will bless all the future generations who will be baptized in this church. So I hope this can be a lasting reminder for us that we can look for and thank God for the blessings that continue to come from this faith that has been nurtured by those who have gone before us. And so we're going to take some time now to sing. And as we sing, I'll be placing the rocks in the font. And I ask those who are willing to come forward and to write a name down of someone in your life who you know is cheering you on today from the next life. Someone who has helped you grow in your faith. And these rocks we're going to place in the prayer garden that we are forming on the side of the church outside. That they will continue to be a lasting reminder of those who carried the lamp of faith for us so that we can now carry it for others. So at this time, I will invite you to stand as you're able and we will sing and come and share the names as we remember those saints who have led us to this point today.